this five minutes ago. So, I'm here to talk about LoRa, which is a LP or low power wide area network, and basically my experiences with that. Yeah. What is LoRa? So basically, it's developed by guys at Semtech, which is a company which came up with this technology, and it stands for long range radio. You know, never tried to Google LoRa and click Google Images. Not good idea. But basically, yeah, that's what it's called. Typically, it's sub gigahertz, so it's below 1 gigahertz, and there's a reason for that. The idea here is you can handle wireless nodes across very wide range, wide distances. So typically, one gateway or what we call a concentrator can support thousands of nodes. And the typical range, it's amazing. A node point to point can reach like 2-5 kilometers or line of sight, up to 50 kilometers. And that was something tested quite recently. Yeah, it's bidirectional, so you can upload and download data. And the thing is, I'm sure you've heard of LoRaWAN as well. And it's important to know that LoRa and LoRaWAN are actually not the same thing. Yeah. Yeah. So the hardware. So the RF modules only come from this company called Semtech. So they are the only makers of this. And generally, it comes in two versions. One is SX1201, which is basically a baseband processor. Really expensive, and something else called SX127X, and these are really cheap. These you can get for Taobao. I don't know, the breakout box can cost $5, but to get the access to SX1301, no Taobao. It costs thousands of dollars, or you need to get special permission from Semtech or some board members. The gateway or concentrators are typically expensive. It would generally put outside of the maker reach, but there are ways for you to bring down the price much lower, and that's something I will talk about later. So basically, LoRa modulation is utilizes a chirp spread spectrum. It utilizes the entire allocated bandwidth to do its stuff, and the idea here is it can reach like really far distances. Yeah, and that's what LoRa modulation basically does. What we have here is that LoRa itself is basically up to the physical layer. So I think this should be quite familiar to most of you guys. So there's the RF layer, the physical layer, the MAC layer, application layer. But LoRa pretty much terminates at the physical layer. Yeah? And then you have LoRaWAN. So basically LoRaWAN is the implementation above that. Yeah. What it does also is the LoRaWAN, even though LoRa you can do point to point, but LoRa you can do point to point, but LoRaWAN, the spec requires you to kind of spread out across different channels. Yeah. The interesting thing about LoRaWAN I find versus things like Sigfox is that there is more, I would say, there is more control on the node side. So I mean, if you think about Wi-Fi, you have Wi-Fi router, and then you deploy a Wi-Fi device and you just connect to it. But for LoRa, you can actually decide, this node is nearer to the gateway or it's further. You can actually tweak to make it perform differently. Yeah, and this is what we call the spread factor. And these are what we say, you can do the trade-offs between range and message duration, and this is quite nice to do. Yeah, and here, because of the fact that it's on multiple channels, you can create this kind of virtual channels to say, okay, this channel I want to dedicate for higher bandwidth, and the rest is for general purpose use, something. It has some encryption here, so it uses ESCCM 128-bit, and it uses some IDs or hash keys on the node itself. Important for LoRaWAN is also the fact that you have three classes of devices. So like I mentioned, you have more control about what a node is. This also involves defining what a node's class is. So the very lowest version of this class is class A. So these are where devices, you have one uplink slot, and two download spots. So and what this means is you can upload as generally class A devices, when you upload is when you download. So if you need to get downloads, it's pretty much when you upload. So if you never ever contact the gateway, you'll never get a download. Yeah. And then class B is where you have upload slots, but you have a dedicated window for downloads. So it could be, I don't know, every 10 uploads, you have a window for this download. Yeah. And class C is the most power hungry one, which is always upload and download, all the time. Yeah. Frequency is also pretty interesting. For LoRa, it really depends on country to country. So, like I said, it's a spectrum of it. Unlike most radio technologies where you actually say 2.4 gigahertz, here you have the spectrum. So for Europe, it's 67 to 869. You have 10 channels. And one of these channels, I think, is for specifically for 50 kilohertz FSK. But North America, it does not have this. For them, it's just 902 to 928. And for Singapore, I'm not sure, it's still not defined yet.
Yeah.
For Singapore?
I have used 433 megahertz.
For Singapore?
Yeah. It's the same.
Is it?
Yeah, it's same as true.
Part of 866 is level.
Okay.
The whole band is level.
Okay.
Part of 433 is level.
Is it
Okay, so it's not like Europe, so it's still some variations there.
There's actually, surprisingly, more frequency
here than this. Ah, that's interesting. Okay. Because I was in Berlin for the past 3 months. Before I left, they were still discussing about it, but it's good. Now they have pretty much defined it, right?
It's been the case for 5 or 6 years.
Oh, no, no. Specifically for LoRa, because when I was talking to the Things Level guys, they were still figuring it out. They were spring.
I'm checking. You're talking about use by service providers. That's a different licensing rate.
Oh, right. No, no, no. Yeah. So in this case, apparently, sorry for the deviation here, but apparently, A68, I was told for long range in Singapore, there were some issues. Something to the effect. That's why during communication, there was some discussion where they need to rectify this somehow. I do not know what's the result of this rectification by the authorities, but somehow
it was the evolving circuit products. Because the recommended use is specifically
For ISM.
Yeah.
Yeah. But
so, the moment you become a service provider, you were run a business selling communication service.
Right.
Then you have to have a discussion about it. That's what I'm thinking.
Well, it would be interesting what the Things That Works Kickstarter project, what they will deliver to us in Singapore, yeah?
It's the difference between the legal space for a service provider
right.
to run a business making money running communication services and hobbyist and non-profit or even commercial use of ISM band devices.
Okay.
So these are two legal dispensations for using the same technology.
Okay, and that's an effect on the LoRa.
You and I think it is different for a service provider.
Right.
Much more room to
play. Okay. Well, that's interesting to look at deeper later. Concentrators. So there's a bunch of concentrators here. Curling is the king, I guess. They are really expensive. Something like 3K to 50K. But if you look from the scale of a city, there's pennies actually. Multi-tech. So there's a Cisco gateway, which I think they're starting to sell. I saw this in Open Berlin. They had something like this. I don't know the price. But the most affordable one is the Things gateway, which is 200 euros. So I'm a backer of this. I'll be pretty much interested to see what kind of frequency they can support. I'm hoping they support the European one, so yes, I can use it in Germany. But what's my fingers? Architecturally, that's how LoRa works. If you can see, there is the end nodes, and then there's the concentrators, but that is where, that's where LoRaWAN kind of stops. So from the node to the concentrator to the network server, there's kind of standardization, but to the backhaul, so you can see from the 3G backhaul, it could be anyone's game. So for Things That Work, for example, they use MQTT to pass on this message across. There's another company we work with, Loriot, HTTP forwarding, So there's no standardization in this area, but at least from the node, edge node to the gateway, it's pretty well defined. So, things that work. This is an interesting initiative. So it started out by Peter Giesman from Netherlands, and it's about coming up with a crowdsourced LoRa network. Yeah? The interesting thing about setting up a LoRa network is for most countries, I don't know, Singapore, you do not need the authorities' permission. it's completely open source, so the entire stack is available on GitHub for you to fork it if you like and set up your own things network. And they have a Kickstarter project. Yeah. So generally, they are offering the gateway and the node itself. Yeah. How they started out was in Amsterdam, where you know, they have this use cases where they found that boats after a while sinks because of flooding. So what they did was they managed to convince a lot of guys to put up gateways there. And right now, I think there's like 50 gateways in that city alone. And they did it completely without the government's involvement. I'll skip this. So I think a lot of these people know there's nodes, gateways, routers, brokers, handlers, and applications. These are the terminologies behind. This is quite specific to things that work. So I do not want to go too deep into this. But what things that work do offer is different kind of deployment models, I would say. So the first one is the public community network. So if you were to get a gateway, a LoRa gateway, and configure it with a Things network, it's pretty much public, which means you can host it there. Anyone who passes by and fires off a LoRa signal to the Things network, it goes through you and goes into the network. You can also fork the entire source code and set up your own private network. So I don't know, good use case would be, I'm a farmer, quite a big area of land, I can fork it, just plug down my gateway and I have a private network, you know? And the second one is, that's the last one, which is completely your own one. There's an interesting one where you can kind of mix this. So you have a private network, but you still use the Things network network to kind of, if there's a packet meant for you, it goes to you. Otherwise, you route it out elsewhere. Same thing for your gateways. If there is a packet meant for you, you consume it. Otherwise, you can route it back to the public network. Eh? They have also a concept for fair use policy. Of course, you don't want people to abuse this. So they have a golden rule, which is 30 seconds of airtime per day. So for 10 bytes of payload, it translates to 20 messages per day at spread factor 12, which is the fastest one, or 500 messages per day, which is smaller, but slower. And typically, the default is spread factor 7. So if application requires more bandwidth, you have to think of not something else other than TPM. Typically, this is a structure for creating an app and devices. You create a user first, your own user on Things network. You create an application. An application consists of this EUI, which is like an ID, and the access keys. Yeah? And for an application, given application, you create devices. And device would consist of the address. SCN up and down would be the count going up and down, how many packets up and down, the network key and the application security key. These are the commands. I really want to show you the demo, but I do not have time. I think there's some configuration changes that we don't have time to look at. But this is typically the commands you use for the Things network. There's a command line tool. You can create a user, create a login, create an application called Hello World, and then in this case you're saying use this application and register a device to this application. And finally, like I said, it's MQTT. So running that command is, you're creating an MQTT subscription to the broker, and you can get subscriptions. This is Europe right now. So Things that work is that there's quite a lot everywhere. And I think when they start delivering their router, I think end of the month or so, hopefully it's going to explode, but yeah, we'll see. A few interesting things about this diagram. When I was in Berlin, I was looking at the Berlin community, there was no community, you know. Okay, sad. And then I set up a gateway, yeah? And then the next day, I thought, oh, let me create one. So when I refreshed, oh no, somebody created a gateway. Then the message there was, we have our first gateway. Oh, let me see who that is. Then I was like, oh, okay, that's Alan's day. That's closer to home. It's Buddha. A155. Wait a minute. That's my gateway. So that's the funny thing about things network. You sometimes, it can be a quite lonely island, you know, for some cities. On the other hand, if you look at this guy over here, this is in Zurich. When I was there 2 weeks ago, four weeks ago, I brought a LoRa node to OneDrive, and there were tons of gateways, so there was no shortage of that. Zurich and Amsterdam. So, you know, it's not so equal right now. Yeah? Over here, this small thing here is interestingly, over there, I would say, they did successfully arrange 50 kilometers from Zurich all the way to Berlin. And I have no idea what they use, but they managed to do this. 50 kilometers, that's amazing. Yeah? I'm guessing this probably one some of the newer curling gateways or something with very powerful antennas. I don't know. So, for things like what is a big bag, you know, you have to understand where you are. I would like to compare you with the other players right now. So there is Waitlist, which I do not know much about. A lot of you guys know Sigfox. There's LoRa and MDIoT, among others. Which is the best? I don't think there's a best. Even though if you read articles, everyone's trying to say they're the best. I think there's a pro and con in each of this. So for example, Sigfox is run by a single player. Good thing about Sigfox is it's coherent. No matter where you are in the world, if you use the Sigfox network, the data coming in is the same, right? For LoRa, like I told you, after the backhaul, it could be anyone's game, it could be MQTT, it could be whatever. Yeah? The con in my case for Sigfox is it's run by one player. They're heavily funded, it's good, but it's a single player. All data still goes through that network. If this company goes down, we do not know. But the good thing is the coherence. LoRa is much more open, but you know, and after the backhaul, like I said, it's much more dicey. But the good thing about LoRa is, like I said, you can just come out with the gateway, put it down in the middle of the field, and you have an ad hoc gateway. There's also MBIoT, which is pushed by Vodafone, among others, where they use existing cellular networks to do LPWAN. Yeah, they claim that all the network needs is an upgrade to the software, and they can do it. But of course, this will be with the SIM cards, and there's some money for that. But it still has a value. You need more. You need better reliability and such. Yeah, maybe IoT would be good there. Yeah? I have no idea about Waitlist. I've heard about them, but so what's next for me? What I have here, I have a couple of hardware here. So the setup I did for LoRa is based on a Pi. This is a single band gateway. So you can get this shields for maybe $30, but it's only a single channel. It's good for testing, but it's not really LoRaWAN. You know, you really cannot really do this. You can see that this small chip here is an SX12, which is a cheaper one. But it's not really meant for production use. I did manage to get that guy. That guy, the board alone cost 200 euros. But this is a full 8-band. You can create a real LoRa gateway. And does anybody know what this guy is? That's a Pi Top C. Have you heard of that? Yeah. So it's a 99 Kickstarter project with a monitor and a Raspberry Pi there. So my plan is to put this guy in there and create a mobile LoRa gateway with screen monitor and everything. Just put it down and you can set up, I don't know, for a hackathon, for a use case, something interesting like that. And that would be my plans right now, because I want to see how far I can push this. Yeah? Unfortunately, I cannot show you the demo right now, but if you're really interested, we can figure out something later to show. Yeah? Yep, that's all.
Was that 10 minutes?